first step outside this bed, never into all the evil.
Thanksgiving edition of the Calling Hours Horror Podcast on Morbidly Beautiful Radio. Once again, it is I, your head undertaker, the dead man Michael Jones of MorbidlyBeautiful.com, Coffin Cuties Magazine, and Digital Dead Magazine. Yes, it is Thanksgiving, and it is time to feast, but tonight we feast on the podcast. On tonight's episode, in our feature interview, we will have actor, producer, and writer Gregory Blair. Some of his past films include Deadly Revisions, Charles Band's Ooga Booga, Garden Party Massacre, and the upcoming films Wall of Flesh, Ugly Sweater Party, and Nick Hunt's Safe Place. He is also the author of the Stonewall award-winning novel Spewing Pulp, The Ritual, and Little Shivers, as well as the stage plays Cold Lang Sin and Nicholas Nickleby. He's really a great interview. He's a fascinating guy, very warm, very intelligent. We talk about a lot of important subjects, especially things like crowdfunding. So make sure to tune in at 8:30 for our interview with Gregory Blair. In our digital dismemberment spotlights this evening, we will be covering Scream Factory's release of The Hunchback from the Morgue, part of the 5-disc Blu-ray Paul Naschy Collection 2. Now, this is considered by many to be Naschy's greatest film, and I find it hard to disagree with that. The film has breathtaking locations and plenty of controversial history, including the taboo of necrophilia and the burning of live rats by fire during the production. Keeping in mind, this was at a point in time in filmmaking before the animal cruelty laws came into play. Not that that's an excuse, but just so you know. In our other digital dismemberment spotlight, we will be covering the online screener release of Lex Ortega's incredibly graphic Atroz, or Atrocious for American Audiences, from Unearthed Films. Now, this is certainly a shocking film, not only for its graphic nature and use of several social taboos and fetishes. The film does speak about the social and political climate in Mexico and how its citizens become victims on what seems to be a daily basis. It's a very powerful film. It's a very controversial film, but I think it's one that hardcore genre fans should definitely check out. In our Metal Massacre spotlights this evening, we will have music from Septic Flesh, Cannibal Corpse, and Cradle of Filth. And as a matter of fact, let's go right into our first spotlight. Once again, the name of the band is Cradle of Filth, the CD is Thornography, and the song is Tonight in Flames.
that I've tossed from the spring of the water of life. He who overcomes will inherit all this. And I will be his God. And he will be my son.
just heard Cradle of Filth from the CD Thornography, and the song was Tonight in Flames. Thornography was the seventh studio album by the English extreme metal band Cradle of Filth. It was released on the 17th of October in 2006 on Roadrunner. Make sure to head on over to Cradle of Filth's official website to find out when they're touring, get their new CD and other merchandise. Coming up in a few minutes, we're going to have our feature interview with actor, producer, and writer Gregory Blair. But before that, it's time for some digital dismemberment. And in our first digital dismemberment spotlight for the evening, we are going to be reviewing the online screener from Unearthed Films. The movie is Atroz from director Lex Ortega. And man, let me tell you, hope you have a strong stomach. Hope bloody and shocking things don't bother you, because that's what this film delivers. To give you the premise, a woman has been brutally struck down by a car, and the two drivers have been obtained by the police. The unorthodox commander-in-chief decides to check out the assailant's car for himself and makes a gruesome discovery on a camcorder. The video recorder features the relentless torture and murder of a prostitute. The police decide to deal some justice of their own, justice that would make even the criminals cringe. By interrogating the perpetrators, they discover more videotapes exposing even more sexually deviant torture and murder. Now, if that doesn't intrigue you out the gate, I don't know what to tell you. There's certainly a fine art to making controversial and ultra-violent films, and it seems like director Lex Ortega, who's also known for Tias for Tamales, Barbarous Mexico, and viral SDT torture porn, has found it. In his film that has just about every taboo attached to it, including torture, rape, coprophilia, urophilia, hematophilia, incest, humiliation, olfactophilia, and pedophoring, the brilliance that helps to put it all over the top is having the controversial Ruggero Deodato, who's most famously known for Jungle Holocaust, Cannibal Holocaust, and House at the Edge of the Park, as a producer. Part of what helps to drive the film is the ability to equate modern-day problems into the storyline. In particular, the horrific murder rate and the staggering amount that are never solved in Mexico. The other part of the equation is the use of handheld media and how it has consumed us. Blurring the lines of distinction of feature film and found footage, Ortega's nightmarish vision is equal parts brutal, sickening, terrifying, and numbing. Adding to the mix is the horrific twist near the end and how much it mirrors events going on in the world today. The film's story and shooting style make it entirely plausible to believe that something like this exists in the world today and that we simply have not seen it released to the general populace. While the found footage era of filmmaking is something that is not new, when done correctly, it certainly brings something different to the table. I personally found it interesting that Deodato was the producer on the film and how his own film Jungle Holocaust is effectively mirrored by Ortega. While Deodato's film was way controversial for its time and resulted in him being charged with murder, which was later dropped after the actors from Jungle Holocaust appeared on an Italian television show, I believe that had Atroz been released any time before this, it could have seen the same thing happen to it. The sheer depravity of the violence and genius camera work would certainly lead one to believe that what they were seeing was real. The film certainly has comparisons to other genre fare, such as Guinea Pig Flowers of Flesh and Blood and Guinea Pig The Devil's Experiment, ironically enough, both released by Unearthed Films. The realistic nature of the effects work and the grainy quality of the footage almost breathlessly leaves you asking if it was all real. And that's certainly a testament to the artists that created the special effects for the film. Now, the real question with a film like this is, does it go too far? Considering the real-life atrocities that we see in life today, I find the answer to be no. While arguments can be made about whether Ortega was making any kind of real political and or social statement with his film, or if he was simply trying to be as disgusting and vile as he could be and label it as art, is open to any viewer's interpretation and for them to decide. However, I think it should be pointed out, to be fair, I don't think the film is misogynistic in any fashion. All three of the taped murder sequences cover the spectrum of the ever-sliding gender scale. The first one deals with a transgendered man-woman who is being violently beaten and killed. The second has a young female being brutally beaten, stabbed, and then raped until her death. And the third tells the story of a tragic young man being sexually humiliated by his mother and father, which eventually leads to their own gruesome deaths. If anything, the film shows that these horrific crimes can happen to anyone, regardless of gender lines or upbringing. The film even hints at the open corruption of the government and the fact that they may have been involved in the entire process. Now, Stephen Biro and Unearthed Films once again bring us something that will haunt your memories and darken your soul. We often find it difficult to believe that such dark corners exist in humanity, both in the arts and in real life. But Ortega masterfully weaves both sides together and gives us something that is both thought-provoking and utterly chilling at the same time. The political and social subtext is something that may be lost on many as they view it as they would films such as a Serbian film or Necromantic, regarding them as nothing more than grotesque titillation and a way to spread the director's perverse way of thinking. However, what should not be lost is the fact that these films have a way of approaching traumas in life like no other, and that's head on. Life is not clean, and not everything has a happy ending. Certainly watch at your own risk and know that you are heading for realms not seen every day. But keep an open mind and realize that what you are seeing is more of a reality for some people than others. Personally, I find this to be a genius piece of filmmaking that should spark conversation and careful introspection. And again, you know, you compare it to films like Jungle Holocaust. You compare it to a Serbian film. The Devil's Experiment, the original guinea pig movie. These are all films that were very haunting, that audiences didn't know how to take. I mean, hell, the original guinea pigs were investigated as snuff films. So you don't know what to expect. So, I mean, personally, I find the film to be amazing. I gave it a 4 out of 5. I'm definitely looking forward to getting my own original Blu-ray copy of it to see what special features are added, what extras there are. But again, Ortega and Steven definitely need to be applauded for making something that will make you think and question your moralities and the things that go on in everyday life. So make sure to head on over to Unearthed Films and order your copy of Atroz. Coming up in just a few moments, in our feature interview, we will be speaking with actor, producer, and writer Gregory Blair. But before that, let's jump into our second Metal Massacre Spotlight. The name of the band is Septic Flesh, the CD is Titan, and the song is Prototype. We'll be right back. You just heard Septic Flesh from the CD Titan, and the name of the song was Prototype. Titan is the 9th studio album by Greek death metal band Septic Flesh, and it was released on June 20th, 2014 through Season of Mist Records. Make sure to head on over to their official site, check them out on Facebook, find out where they're on tour, and where you can pick up their latest releases and merchandise. But now it's time, ladies and gentlemen, for our feature interview of the evening. Okay, and on this interview, we are going to have a very talented filmmaker, a gentleman that has been brought to my attention, and people have been telling me for a while that I need to check out his work. Let's say hello, ladies and gentlemen, to Gregory Blair. Gregory, how are you doing this evening?
Thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Oh, it's no problem. And again, you don't know how much I appreciate. We had to get this one in on short notice. So a lot of people were expecting one thing and they're going to get another. But I really feel like they are going to really enjoy the discussion. So for people that don't know, Gregory does many a thing in the industry. I mean, he's a director. He's done acting, producing, writing. Kind of tell people how you first got involved with the industry.
Well, let's see. So I guess I had started off acting in theater and then writing there as well. And I think it was, gosh, we gotta go back. What was the first thing I did for a film? Well, the first thing when I was a kid, actually, I auditioned for a particular film project, which I didn't get, so it was my first rejection, so, and this business is full of that, so you get used to it pretty quickly. But then, I don't know, things just started happening once, just I took a break from the acting thing and went to school and started studying writing and other stuff. And when I came back and started getting into it, I think the first thing that I did was a short film called The Great Venice Robbery. I think that was the first thing. If it wasn't that, it was a film called Crackpot. These are things that I don't even know if you can see them. I don't know if they're out there anymore or not. But those are things that I started with. So I started actually with film. And then branched into television. That's as an actor, and then branched into television after that, and I was writing all the time. Switched from writing plays to writing screenplays, and then I started doing well with screenplays, and some of those have sold, and or I made them myself, sure. Which is how I ended up getting into directing and producing. So it was just I just kept adding hats that I could wear along the way, and here I am with, you know, a closet full of hats.
Oh, I mean, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. And now I'm looking at your IMDb, so if you know, things are wrong, titles are wrong, dates are wrong, please feel free to correct me. But one of the things that jumped out at me right away was you were actually a club patron and a zombie in Zombie Strippers.
That always catches people's attention.
So tell us,
and how could it not?
Tell us a little bit about your experience on the set. You know, were you on set with Robert Englund? You know, what was that experience like?
It was great. I wish I could say I was on set with Robert Englund, but I was not in those scenes. But the set was great. His name Jay something. It's off the top of my head. Who was directing it, really ran a tight ship, and Nick was great. The guys in the makeup were outstanding. It really made some of the zombies quite spectacular. There was one guy, I call him the jaw guy, because he had sort of his jaw like hanging off the side of his face, and it was a whole prosthetic, and it was really cool. And I was really kind of envious of that, because, you know, you know, obviously he hadn't been hit by a car or whatever, so I didn't look as cool as he did. But when it came time to, like, eating lunch, I was really happy I wasn't John Guy.
Right.
I had to feed pretzels through a hole in his jaw, practically. So, you know, pluses and there are benefits and both sides of that sort of a thing. But yeah, it was a lot of fun. We got sprayed with like 3 or 4 different kinds of blood to make it look unique and realistic, and it was cold as all. I'll get out. So, you know, we're down in the basement of this abandoned hospital, and it's cold, and now we're dripping wet, and we're sticky, and I'm thinking, yep, I never want to be in Carrie. So,
you know,
but since then, I've been so covered in blood in other films that, you know, it's just part of the being involved in that genre.
Oh, for sure, for sure. Now, your first directing credit, again, according to IMDb, was the absolutely fantastic film Deadly Revisions. And, of course, that was released by SGL Entertainment. And, you know, I'm a huge fan of Bill Oberst Jr. I mean, there's so much of his work that, I could, you know, to me, I remember interviewing him one time on the podcast, and I had told him, you know, in a lot of ways, I compare him to Bill Moseley. And I told him I hope he took that as a compliment, because Bill Moseley is one of my favorite actors as well. But there's just something about Bill. Now, when you made this film, when you wrote it, you know, what drew you to having Bill in that lead role?
Interesting. Well, usually when I'm writing scripts, I don't even think about actors or types or anything. I'm completely all about the whatever the character is, and so I wrote this with nobody in mind. That has changed somewhat over the years, but with that one I didn't. And what happened was, I put it aside. I think I tried to shop it, and nothing. I didn't get any traction. I thought, okay, fine. Yeah, and I thought, and it's perfect too, because, you know, it's low budget, because it's almost one location, not a lot of characters, and, you know, it's something everybody wants. But long story short, I met Bill at a function. I forget what, he was sort of speaking at this seminar or something, and we met, and we, interestingly enough, I met Donna the exact same event. So that was kind of a momentous event, now that I think about it. But we clicked right away, and he and I just sort of started hanging out, became kind of friends, and we talked about doing a project together, and we just couldn't figure out what project it was, and I started trying to write something, and suddenly it occurred to me, this Deadly Revisions, this is really something you should do. And so I gave him the script, and he loved it. And so then I went to a friend of mine who I said, you know, do you want to help me with this? And that was my producer, Roxy. She said, yeah, I'll produce it, and you'll direct it, and it'll be great. She was kind of like a crazy Asian Judy Garland. Let's put on a show, you know. So she's that. She's got the greatest energy and personality. So that's really kind of almost what she is in a way. Bill was into it, and I thought, well, there you go. I said, and it's so perfect in a way, because you always play the bad guy and the crazy killer. And here in this movie, theoretically, you're the Jamie Lee Curtis character. You know,
right.
I thought, how cool will that be to watch you be in that role? Even though, you know, as the film goes on, you start to question exactly what and who he is, all that jazz. But yeah, so that's pretty much how it happened. Once I put two and two together, I put the character with Bill, I went, oh my gosh, this is gonna work.
You know,
so
and
that's
how
it happened.
He really is such a dynamic presence on the film. I remember the first film that I saw him in was Billy Pond's Circus of the Dead. And then
which is a totally different animal altogether.
Exactly. And like you said, most of the time when you see Bill in a film, Bill is playing the bad guy. He's the villain. He, you know, he's the antithesis of pure and good. But when SGL Entertainment sent me Deadly Revisions, and it said, you know, Bill Oberst. And I was like, oh, man, this should be interesting. And I went into the film at first kind of thinking that Bill was once again going to be this horrifically evil person. But the thing that I found, even in his earlier work now, is that he's just such a dynamic and powerful performer. And I think he really brought that across really, really well in your film. You know, are there any plans for you to do more stuff with him coming up here in the future?
There are no plans to date, but I'm sure if something comes up, he'll say yes. And it would be my pleasure, because he's not just terrific on screen. He's terrific off screen. He's wise. He's considerate. He is extremely professional. In person, he's the antithesis of what he usually plays, because he's usually a screaming, evil, nasty, horrible, murderous, spitting, awful, you know, the worst of the worst. And in person, he is just, he's like a southern gentleman.
He's definitely one of the most...
Yeah, he's great to have around.
He's one of the most humble actors I have ever directed, and I've had, you know, or directed, interviewed. And like I said, I've been able to interview him on the podcast, and I've done, you know, email interviews with him, and he's just so gracious with his time. So I really hope that I see the two of you guys working together again, because I think that would be highly entertaining to see.
Well, I would love to do something again with him.
Now, the next...
Go
ahead.
I'm going to jump off just because I'm reminded I do have another script that I wrote pretty much with the two of us in mind. While we were on the set of Deadly Revisions, we talked horror films, of course, and there was something at one point he said, you know, this is something that they never do, and I thought, well, that's true, and so we talked about that, and I thought, I need to remedy that. And so I wrote a script for the two of us to be in that would sort of go to this place where at that time I don't think any other horror film had gone. Now we've progressed now, because that was, gosh, when we started making that, that was what, five years ago? Let's see, 2012. Yes, that's 5 years ago. So a lot has happened in 5 years, and horror movies have, well, all movies have sort of, we've gone from leaps and bounds. So it'll be interesting to see if I can get that script into other people interested in it besides the two of us, and see where that goes. So maybe that will be the thing we do. I don't know. That's just something that came into my head to mention. So there you go.
Now, the next film listed on IMDb that I had a question about, and again, to me, it goes back and it references a historical character in the genre, was you were part of Charles Band's Ooga Booga. And again, looking at that cast, you know, you had some names in that. Karen Black, you know, Stacey Keach.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but what it reminds me of is I think of the Zuni fetish doll from Trilogy of Terror.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's totally what they're spoofing, and the Karen Black was so gracious to jump in and be involved in what is essentially a spoof of herself in that Zuni fetish doll segment of that film. Is just, you know, it's, for me, it's the best thing in the movie. I just love it.
Now, it's just curious, because I've tried to get Charles on the show, and Charles is such a busy guy. He's hard to pin down, but
yeah,
he's, again, to me, he's one of those legendary people in the industry. Can you talk about what was it like working with him, and what did you take away from working with him that you've helped, you know, used to help incorporate into your films and to make your films better?
The thing about Charles that I most sort of noticed and admired and took away from the set
was he is so relaxed. He is so relaxed. I mean, you have, I think there's the stereotype of the director who's basically steam is coming out of his ears, and because everything is falling apart, and he's this histrionic, crazy lunatic. And you really can't be that. You have to be so prepared and so professional and so experienced that you set the tone for the entire experience. And that's kind of what Charles does. It was a great thing for me to see on the set. He was just so completely, utterly relaxed. If something didn't go right, it was fine. If we needed to do this instead of that, it was fine. It was like, you know, I don't know, maybe he was drunk, I'm kidding. But, you know, whatever it was, I took that as extremely valuable. And that's what I try to do on my sets as well.
Sure. Now, just as we'll go off on a short tangent here, you know, again, looking over your IMDb, I've noticed how much television that you've done. And I always ask this of people that work in both television and film. For you, do you find it easier to work on television, or do you prefer the medium of film better?
They are so similar nowadays, more so, I think, than they used to be. It used to be that, you know, it was a lot of sitcom was, you know, 3 and 4 camera setups, which they still do that now. I mean, Love That Girl was that, and I love that too, because that's a little more like working in theater.
Sure.
It's usually very bigger and more broad, and there are cameras everywhere, so they can, you don't have to do quite as many takes because, you know, they're capturing it from all the angles at the same time. So there's all of that. So that's great, but a lot of TV now is single cam, so it's filmed like film. Are filmed in a way, more or less, and so there's less of a difference now. You look at so much of television now is like movies, you know, Game of Thrones and yada yada, all these things, they look like movies. So there's really, the reason they look like movies is because they're filmed like movies, and so there's less difference now. So which one do I like more? As long as I like the story and the characters, it doesn't really matter to me at all. That's the truth. I like them both.
Now, you brought up theater as well.
Probably wasn't.
No. I mean, it's a good answer, and you know, you brought up theater too. And I remember we're going to keep bringing Bill up here, but you know, I remember talking to Bill because he's done theater, and I asked him, you know, from an acting standpoint, does theater help you when it comes to doing film, you know, and he felt it did because it helped with, you know, knowing where you need to be stage presence wise, how to project your voice, things like that. For you as a director, how do you feel about working with actors that are more classically theatrical trained as opposed to actors who work just strictly for television or for movies?
Mostly, I would say that I prefer actors who have theatrical training and theatrical experience. And the reason for that, film and theater, they're very different animals, and you do need different, there are different techniques that you use in acting for theater versus film. But theater actors know how to approach a character and memorize lines in a way that a lot of, in my experience, at least on the indie side of things, doesn't happen in the same way with actors or actresses who haven't had that kind of training. I've gone on set and I've seen actors and actresses with the scripts in their hands, still as if they're trying to learn their lines on set that day. And I'm like, you know, this is all work that should have been done a long time ago. Now, there are exceptions to that. If you're in If you're on a soap opera that shoots every day and you're getting new scripts handed to you 5 minutes before you actually film, you don't have a chance, you know, then you're obviously learning lines right beforehand. But you've got a film that you got hired to do, and 3 months later it's time to shoot the movie, and you're still looking at stuff? unless it's just to reference it. Wait, what scene did this follow? Because you're not shooting it in order, obviously. You know, theater people, they're going to be up there for 2 solid hours without a script in their hands. They gotta know every minute of it. They've got to know everything. And I think that people who are just trained to do that automatically have it, and they do it. And they don't even think about it. So that would be the one difference, is there's, I just think, a level of, I don't want to say dedication, it's just a level of practice that you have to have and learn and do in theater, that if you haven't had that, then, you know, it's a skill you're kind of missing. And unless you learn to do it, as all of the great actors do, I think it can be problematic.
I think, of course, you know, I work on a lot of indie stuff, and it's interesting to see the difference between working with someone who has just worked exclusively in theater and stage, as opposed to have been in front of a camera. You can kind of see the difference. It's like they're really good with hitting their marks and knowing where they need to stand and things like that. So I find that to be an interesting aspect of the behind the scenes that the everyday fan never gets to see, or doesn't even have any concept of how these things are shot and blocked and things like that. So
sure.
Again, I find it to be an interesting aspect of the whole thing. Now, before we start to get into more of your films, because there are certainly more that I want to talk about, I wanted to ask you a few questions on filmmaking in general. Would you say, first of all, that is horror your first love, or is it just filming in general?
That's an interesting question. I've always liked movies, and horror is just one of the genres I've always liked. I always liked comedies. I always liked I liked horror all along. I grew to like become a big sci-fi fan. It's kind of, I would say film in general is a more honest answer, even though I like horror. I would say, yeah, film in general. And if you look at my library of screenplays I've written, there's a good chunk of horror, but there's a lot that isn't. You know, I've done biographies and dramas and fantasies and comedies. And
sure.
So, you know, it's whatever. I tend to be cast in horror a lot, and I tend to be cast in comedy a lot, but that's because I'm a character actor and I have that kind of face that's either funny or scary, I guess. So, you know, you use what you have, and there you go.
So, let me ask you this. Crowdfunding. You know, mm-hmm. typically it was a way for the independent filmmaker to get his project started, to get the ball rolling. But we're starting to see more and more that larger studios are starting to use crowdsourcing and crowdfunding to get their projects made. As a filmmaker yourself, what are your thoughts on that? Should the big budget studios be, for lack of a better term, double dipping off of the fans to get projects made? Like, for example, what was it? The Veronica Mars thing. You know, that, you know, that was a big budget thing, and they got, you know, they started hitting the fans up, you know, well, we need money to make it, even though it was a successful series. Do you think that should be a tool that's still more for the independent film maker?
Well, in theory, from a sense of equality and fairness and maybe even democracy, it should be available to anyone to do it. That's really how I think you have to feel about that. That's not to say that I don't sort of wonder, or I don't feel the sense that, you know, when you have somebody who is an independent, you know, filmmaker, and maybe this is their first film, and they do not have the portfolio to go out and reach high-level investors and whatnot, you know, crowdfunding may be one of the few tools at their disposal, whereas when you do have a company that has a successful product, they can very easily put together a portfolio or whatever and get investors, and then they do crowdfunding. It feels, I mean, this is what I think you're talking about, it feels like, come on, can't you just leave that, because you're basically almost stealing money from the little guy. Which isn't really true, because chances are the person who is going to give money to Veronica Mars is probably not going to give money to the independent film that isn't in the same genre and isn't, you know, remotely the same. So, I know that's a convoluted answer, but really I think the answer is that, yes, emotionally it feels kind of like, come on, big boys, play the big boys and leave the little fish in the little pond, what little water there is in their pond. But at the end of the day, the only way for it to be fair and equal is for it to be available to everybody.
So, sure.
There you go.
Now, the other thing I want to talk to you about is distribution.
Oh.
I remember the first podcast I ever did, I had Matt Farnsworth on, who did the Orphan Killer. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but when I talked to him about distribution, they went with the self-distribution route. And one of the interesting things that he had mentioned to me was they had found out through various means that the film had been illegally downloaded over a million times.
Oh, God.
So for you, with the way things are going in Hollywood, and it seems like we're starting to see a spark in horror again, because you look at how well It did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, do you think the way to go for independent filmmakers is to try and go through a studio? Or do you feel like things like Netflix and all of these independent horror channels and Hulu and things like that are really the way for you to really get your project out there for people to see them?
You know, it's been changing so quick. I feel like the minute I give you an answer, I'll have to change it in 10 minutes.
Right.
But, yes, because there used to be some self-distribution was just like something that didn't exist hardly 10 years ago. I mean, nobody even thought about it. And now there's, you know, Distriver and all these platforms that will help you do it yourself. And that never even existed before. Of course, that's sort of, if you do it yourself, it's going to cost you all of the money up front that normally a distributor might take on some of those costs. But also, it's about marketing, because, you know, distributors have more, theoretically, more money to play with marketing to get your film seen and get it into more places than you may be able to do on your own, blah, blah, blah. So, but even if you get a smaller piece of the market, it's all yours, and all the profit is yours if you self-distribute. Well, all the profit that the platforms don't take. Everybody gets a piece of the pie. So what's the best answer? I think you have to decide on what your goal is. I mean, if you're dreaming big numbers, emphasis on dream, but if you're dreaming big numbers, then you need to play with the big boys. You need to get a distributor, probably, and you need to try to, you know, go that route and get your film into movie theaters. Blah, blah, blah. On the other hand, some things can be very successful just through VOD. But it depends on, again, marketing is a big part of that. And so if you have the funds to afford to do the kind of marketing that's going to get people's eyes on the product, then you know, then you have, you can sort of make those choices a little bit more easily. So, you know, I'm sorry, do you want the answer is what should filmmakers do today? I haven't a clue. You know, I'm with the distributor for Deadly Revisions. I will probably, at this point, I'm probably going to go with the distributor for Garden Party Massacre.
Which we'll bring up here in a little bit. We're definitely going to talk about Garden Party Massacre. But, you know,
Go ahead.
No, go ahead and finish your thought, because there's one last little piece to this I'm going to ask you about.
Okay, I was just going to say, for my next film, might I do self-distribution? Entirely possible. I don't think there's... It's not like it... equated to in publishing, back in the day, you could publish your own book, and it was called a vanity press. And it was kind of pathetic, is what it was. I don't think self-distribution is like that at all. I don't think it's pathetic at all. I think it can be extremely savvy and beneficial and good business. So, there you go. That's all I wanted to say.
Now, the last piece I want to ask you about, because they've certainly become much more of a force now, is what are your thoughts on Netflix? I mean, you look at things like Stranger Things has done really well as a Netflix exclusive. I just watched The Babysitter, and I have to be perfectly honest, that's probably, as it sits right now, that's probably my top film, horror film of the year, and we're starting to see more and more of this quality content being distributed exclusively through Netflix. What do you think about them becoming a player in the industry?
I think it's great. The more players, the better, I think, because the more outlets there are that need content and or are creating, if they need content and or are creating content, creating content creates the need for writers and actors and blah, 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 blah. So that's great. And if they're looking for content, that's great too. So, I mean, to me, the more the merrier. I think it's great. You know, we used to sit with, you know, studios, it's like, gosh, they've only put out X number of films this year. And where are all the movies? You know, now there's bazillions. And, you know, sure, it's not all going to be great, and it's not all going to be to your taste, but the more there are, the more likely there's going to be something that is to your taste that you are going to like. And it's more is better, more jobs, more everything. I think it's good.
Well, I agree. Like I said, I mean, the quality of and I can only speak to horror. I mean, I don't want to seem like a movie snob, but with the podcast and with the magazines and everything, my focus is primarily on horror, so that's what I watch, and I'm just starting to see so much quality content coming out in all of these other venues other than film or through a big studio. So I definitely think it's something to watch. It's very interesting, and it, you know, it gives me pause, because one day, you know, yeah, I would love to direct my own film, and the, you know, it used to be that your only option was to go through a studio. So I think it is nice to see other things out there.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think it's great.
So to get back to your films for a second, again, looking on IMDb, I see one, and there's no date listed for it, but what can you tell us about The Straying? Because I see, of course, your name, and I see Bill's name attached to it.
That is the film I was talking about earlier.
Okay.
That we talked about wanting to do, and finished the script. And so now it's just a question of deciding really how we want to move forward, because it's a little bit a question of timing and then obviously a question of funding and all of that stuff. And so right now it's just
that's the stage it's in. It's that the script is done, and I'm not 100% sure what the next step is, because I don't want to direct and produce it. I wore all three hats for Garden Party Massacre, and while that was a terrific experience, I don't think I want to repeat it. Hopefully I don't repeat anything throughout my life. Life's too short to repeat stuff. So since I want to, at the moment, play opposite Bill and be an actor, and really it's almost a two-person film, there's no opportunity, or it doesn't make sense for me to try to pretend that I'm going to be able to be behind the camera and on and around. So that's where that film is right now.
Now, if you can answer the question, which of you would play the werewolf and which is playing the vampire?
Bill's the werewolf.
See, now I think that would be interesting.
Yeah, I really, really like it, but it's a tricky piece because for several reasons. Apparently that it's only two characters, you know. It takes it's a certain kind of audience gets excited by that, you know. There aren't a lot of movies that do that. I mean, usually they're dramas. The Room, The Babadook was kind of that. That's a horror film, though. But there aren't a lot of those where it's just two characters. It's hard, I think, for audience members to, you know, get excited by that. Didn't the first song was only two people, mostly, you know. So there are exceptions to that, but it's a tough setup. You gotta have a good script. Hopefully people think my script is good enough. It also is a period piece, so it's expensive. Or somewhat expensive. And then the subject matter is, I'm not even going to give away the subject matter, but it's a little more, I would say, social commentary, philosophical, than your average monster movie might be. So it's pretty adult, and it's going to have a niche audience. So, you know, we need a team. We need to get a team that totally understands that, gets it. Can get investors that are excited about that, to see that kind of thing, and to be aware of how best to market that kind of thing. So, you know, there are hurdles.
Now, the next one, again, no date, but you're listed as the writer and then as an actor, and it looks like two of the other names attached are great actresses that I've interviewed in the past. Donna Lee Heising and Maria Olson, and that's the Dead Hamptons. Is there anything you can tell us about that one?
Well, I can tell you that one is that's a murder mystery is not the right word, because you know who the killer is. Let's say it's a suspense drama, maybe might be the better word. It deals with rich people in the Hamptons, and some of them are getting killed, and so there's a detective who has to try to figure out who it is, and that's pretty much all I can say. That is being produced by somebody other than I, so I don't feel that I'm at liberty to talk too much more about it, unfortunately, because I don't even know the status of it at this point.
Sure, and I don't want to put you on the spot. It definitely caught my eye because, like I said, Maria and Donna, you know, I think are very talented actresses, so it'll be very interesting to see the two of them together. Now, the last one...
Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to say, the last one that was... Go ahead.
Yeah. No, hit, go, let's go.
Well, the last
Take
one I...
the reins.
The last one I was going to ask you about that doesn't have a date next to it is Beasts of the Field. And that one caught my eye. You know, you can laugh at me if you want. I've always been a big pro wrestling fan, and I saw Al Snow's name attached to it.
Yeah, I don't know a whole lot about that because the cast has been going up and changing a little bit over time. It's going to be I would call it an adventure survival film. Really, even though it kind of sounds like a horror film, it's not really a horror film. It's like, is Jurassic Park a horror film? It's scary. It's really more of a adventure film, isn't it? I don't know. Anyway, that's what this is. And I play the lead guy who is, he's like an anti-hero, you know? He's leading this, this expedition into the forest, and he's really not a very good leader. So it's things befall the people en route, and let's just say not too many people end up alive by the end.
Okay.
I can reveal that much. I don't know. Again, since I'm not the director producer. I don't want to give away too much. And, you know, as I said, since we haven't even gotten into production yet, things may change. But that's the gist of it there.
Now, we'll talk about some other ones that are listed as in post-production or completed. Now, the first one immediately jumped out because I've always said, damn it, we need more Christmas-themed horror movies. Please tell me about Ugly Sweater Party.
Ugly Sweater Party is going to be probably a cult Christmas annual thing. It's exactly what you imagine. It's horror comedy. Aaron Mento has just a crazy funny sense of humor, and his script is crazy. It's kind of about a possessed, ugly sweater.
I'm so in for this.
So, you know, all of these, they're at a camp. These guys go to a camp. I remember. Oh, yeah, because I'm a priest in it. And, so imagine a Bible camp with ugly sweaters, and one of them is possessed, and then... Well, you know, people die.
I'm already loving this. Now, Tiffany Brooke Fest is in that with you, and the other film I was going to ask you about, or one of the other ones, is Serena Waits, and you're in that with her as well. What can you tell us on that one?
Serena Waits is sort of a... it's a revenge flick, but in a way, it's kind of a ghost story. The script, the twist of the end is so clever, I don't want to give away too much, but basically it's about, you know, a couple of guys who get way too drunk, if I remember correctly, drunk, but it might be drugs, I can't remember, and they basically kill this, I think it's Serena, who, like, it was supposed to be date rape, but she actually ends up dead, and they're mortified, and they try to hide any trace of what happened, but Serena doesn't really like that. So suddenly people start dying, and it's very interesting. I basically... my role is like the, Drew Barrymore in Scream. I'm in the opening kind of prologue scary scene.
Oh, okay. So that ought to be good.
It was a lot of fun to shoot.
Now, the next one I want to bring up, I know you guys haven't started shooting yet, and Nick Hunt will eventually, I should be taping an interview with him here in the next couple of days, And that's Safe Place. And again, mm-hmm. I look over the list of who's involved with it. Of course, Bill's involved with that. Genevieve Rossi's on that. I've had her on. I've mm-hmm. interviewed her. You know, I know you can't give away too much about it because you guys haven't started filming yet. But can you give people kind of the premise of the film?
Sure. The premise of the film is an art student and a bunch of her friends. They all go to a showing of her artwork, and they hook up with an older guy who invites them back to his house for beers to celebrate. And because he's actually bought one of her paintings, so, you know, she almost feels obligated. So they go to his house because he seems like, you know, he's okay. Well, it turns out he is not okay. While he declares his house a safe place, it's anything but. And so I play that character. His name is Chris Craven. And he's a crazy MF-er. And he's obsessed with death and death rituals. And basically, because of something horrible that happened in his past, he kind of has the view that all life is suffering. And so what better thing to do than help people just end it all? And so that's kind of what he does.
Yeah, I'm really excited. I'm really excited.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, really excited. We keep stepping on each other. I'm really excited for this one because, Nick was definitely, you know, he's told me about it. I'm really excited about the premise, you know. He certainly, the link between you and I, you know, we have to thank Nick for recommending you for the interview. I'm just really excited for that, and I hope it goes well. It just seems like the kind of thing that I would really be into, so I'm excited for that.
All right, well, I hope that you are pleased with the end product.
So let's get into specifically one of your films, and I want to go ahead and say this so that people know. Tomorrow night at Zedfest Film Festival, you're going to be screening your film, Garden Party Massacre. And, yes. You know, like I said, I've talked to Donna. Donna's mentioned this to me. Tiffany's mentioned this film to me. Marv Blavelt, you know, the few times I've talked to him, he's mentioned it to me. Since this is your film, this is the one, tell us about this film. I'm really excited to see this. I'm hoping I'll be able to screen this at some point for a review in one of the magazines or for Morbidly Beautiful.
I think we're from the right now, people. So, Garden Party Massacre is a horror comedy, and it's about a beggar gathering that goes awry when an uninvited guest shows up with a pickaxe and a really bad attitude. And it's just everything you can imagine. It spoofs horror films. It spoofs, specifically, I think, low-budget indie films. It spoofs some of society today to some degree. I think it's a lot of fun. I came up with the title and it made me laugh, and I thought, I have to write a movie as funny as this title. And so that's kind of was my goal. It's just, there are these wacky characters, and it's just fun. And apparently other people think so too, because we've been winning some awards, so I'm not alone, thank God. Because sometimes, you know, you write stuff and you're like, well, I think it's good, I wonder if anybody else will.
No, I'm definitely excited for it. I mean, I've been hearing about the film for a while, and it's definitely caught my attention. So, if you guys ever want a review for it, man, I would love to get one up on Morbidly Beautiful. Like I said, get it in the Coffin Cuties magazine. Anything I can do to help you guys promote that, I would definitely be up for that. So we'll have to talk about that off air one day.
Okay, I'm all for it.
Now, the next one I'm going to ask you about, it seems like I've been hearing about this one for a year or two, and if you want to talk about the Horror Hall of Fame, this movie's it. And of course, I'm talking about Death House. I mean,
Right.
you look at the list of names: Adrian Barbeau, Tony Moran, Sid Haig, Michael Berryman, Kane Hodder, Dee Wallace, Barbara Crampton, Bill Moseley, Tony Todd, Tiffany Shepis, the list goes on. Talk
Yeah.
about how you got involved with this film and what, being a director, I'm sure you don't get starstruck very often, but when you hear that list, when you see those names, kind of talk about what that's like. I mean, because you're basically talking modern day horror royalty in this film.
Yeah, the cast is great, and I think everyone is gonna get a kick out of the film. I got involved actually. I just got I don't know if it was a phone call or a text or something. Felissa Rose was actually involved in the film as well, along with, oh my gosh, Maxwell Lasso was in it. I don't know, there were so many people. Charles Trudobal was in it with me, and Marv is in it, and I mean, everybody and their mother was in this movie
I mean, that's what I'm
in some
saying.
small way. Yeah, I think I got a text or a phone call from her or one of the people I just mentioned. I can't even remember. I have to look back, and they said, "You want to be in this movie? We're shooting this. They need a. They're doing a very specific scene, and they need this." And I said, "I can do that." So that's how it happened. And so the scene that I managed, this is one big scene. There's a lot of us. I don't want to give anything away, so I won't give you specifics about the scene.
Sure.
But two things I can share is, number one, again, when I talk about really capable, impressive directors in action, watching Harrison Smith in action was a treat. Again, he's calm. He is clear-headed. He's totally gracious. It's great to watch great directors work. So that was a treat. When I could actually pay attention to him, once the camera's rolling, we're paying attention to what we're doing. And the other thing I remember, only because you mentioned Starstruck, I'm trying to remember the last time I got Starstruck. I don't know. I can't think of anything off the top of my head, but I'm sure it's happened. But I don't as much, maybe because I've been around enough. I don't know. I don't know. At one point, Dee Wallace walked in, and she was not in our scene, but I guess she was in the later scene or whatever. But she shows up on set, and I can't remember. It's in the middle of the take. I'm pretty sure it's the middle of a take. Somebody's cell phone goes off. I mean, that's bad in a movie theater, but on a set, it's like, what SOB's phone could that be? And all of a sudden, Dee Wallace goes, "Oh shoot, that's me!" And the whole place fell apart laughing. So that's my little Dee Wallace story.
Hey,
She's adorable.
I can't say anything because I remember being on set of The Evil Woods, and I had the big booming voice on set, so whenever they yelled for quiet on the set, they always looked at me and I would yell quiet on the set. So I yell quiet on the set, we get ready to start filming. And I had borrowed someone's cell phone because mine died, so I wasn't used to the ringtone. So I yell quiet on the set, and this cell phone starts ringing, and I don't even realize it's the cell phone in my pocket. And I'm like, who in the fuck didn't turn their cell phone off? And I'm yelling, and then I realize it's the phone in my pocket. I turned about 900 shades of red, so I have been there. I know how that goes. So
We're all human, and it happens.
we're almost at the end here, so I have two more that I'm going to ask you about real quick, and I realize you may not be able to
Sure.
give a lot of details. The first one is Fang. What can you tell us about Fang?
Fang is gonna be amazing. It is such it's such a cool, unexpected movie. Adam Seigert wrote this script that just, it's so full of the unexpected. You know, it's being sold, obviously, as a werewolf movie. But I'm telling you, it is so much more than that. I mean, there is a werewolf, but there are some other non-human entities lurking in that movie, and you just won't know what's coming. That's one of the things that I love about this script, is it starts off very, it kind of lulls you into thinking it's going to be a normal movie. You know, there's these kids, and they accidentally shoot somebody, so from a they, oh, we'll go hang out with my relatives I have. They live in this house. I haven't seen them in a million years. And, you know, something bad will happen in the house. But once you get to the house, nothing you expect happens. It's so bizarre, and it's so gloriously creepy and weird, and it gets very bloody. I think
nothing
it's going to be a
real
thrill ride.
Well, I'm excited.
No, it's...
And I'm excited for that because you'll be working with Melantha Blackthorne in that, and she's someone that I've covered her career for several years, so it should be fun to see that.
She is so great in it too. She's a lovely woman. Oh my gosh, I thoroughly enjoyed being with her on set. And she is, and she like Bill is so lovely in person, and then they you know, and he puts, you know, just a little makeup on her and turns the camera on and says, okay, now be your character in this movie. And it's like, you don't want to be anywhere near her. She is that scary. It's great. It's great. It's great acting, you know. You got to love it.
Now, the last one I'll ask you about, and of course now this one is announced. I don't expect, you know, that you would have much info to tell me on that. But again, you're attached with Bill on this, and that's Evil's Toy.
Yes, Evil's Toy. This is a Cheryl Compton creation. She's written the script, and at this point, I'm not sure if she's... I think she's intending to produce, but I'm not 100% sure on that. It's that is a... what can I tell you? It's sort of a... I'm not sure how to describe it. It's a horror film, certainly. And Bill plays this evil entity, I think is the safest way to describe it. It doesn't give anything away. It doesn't make it confusing too much. That sort of haunts and makes life miserable for this young woman. And I play her. Professor, I have this. I have a really great scene. I can't wait to play. but that's really all I can tell you about that right now. I can't really tell you much more.
Sure. Now, I always try to ask this of actors, directors, anyone that comes on the show, just because I just find it interesting. I myself am not a big fan of remakes, but you know. If you had a dream project, if there was, and we'll keep it in the horror realm, but if you have something outside of the horror realm too, that's fine. If you could remake a horror film, what would it be and why?
If I could remake a horror film, what would it be and why? That is such an interesting question. There are probably several. I would remake, boy, that's tough.
I know what you
mean. I think it would be interesting, I think, to remake Hush, Hush, Sweet Charlotte, actually. I mean, that cast, you know, in general, I don't like remakes. And certainly when you have something that iconic, I think it's more ironic to make a remake. But you said it's a dream and it's a fantasy. In a fantasy world, I would love to remake that movie and, you know, do it and just make some different choices.
Sure.
When I saw that movie as a little kid, It absolutely terrified me. I had to keep turning the television off because it so freaked me out. I had to like go outside in the sunshine and whatnot. And then when I was okay, I'd come back in and watch some more. But because I did that, I missed things. And because I missed them, the ending for me was so much more amazing than if you actually watch the film. They like give shit away, pardon my French, like halfway through the movie. And while sometimes that works, because I had this romanticized memory of it, it's never worked for me.
Sure.
It makes the movie, instead of being like looking from the inside out, I just sort of feel like you just ruined the end of the movie for me here. I don't why did you do that? So I would remake it and take that element out of it. But
no, that's,
you know,
that's fascinating.
It's a living to have it on Betty Davis, so I wouldn't bother in reality.
I mean, out of all the genre films that people could mention, that's one that has just absolutely never come up, and I think that's a fantastic choice. Good call on
that.
Well,
you know, I'm weird. So that I should think of something no one else would is not a surprise.
But I think it could be, I think you're right. If it was, you know, if it was done nowadays, you could definitely do something different with that. I'd be interested in seeing that. Good call. Well, Gregory, I want to thank you so much for being on. And before I let you go, you know, is there anything you want to tell your fans, the people that love your films, and where can people follow you, social media-wise, websites, things like that?
Oh, wow, boy. Well, Google, obviously, and you'll find me, but I think it's, I go by The Gregory Blair, The Gregory Blair on Instagram and Twitter. Actually, I think that might be my Facebook thing, too. I can't remember. But I'm on all of those. Obviously, they can look me up on IMDb. I have a website. Again, if you Google me, I'm sure all this stuff will come up. There's probably sites that are about me that I don't even know of. I found one the other day. There's like celebrity something something, and I was like, oh, look, there I am. Who knew? I forgot how it came up, a Google alert or something. And I just kind of laughed and went, okay. Well, I guess I'm there too now. You know, the internet is crazy, and you never know where you're going to end up. It's and as long as we keep net neutrality, I guess I'll make a plug for that. It'll continue to be free and glorious and expansive and wonderful. So, you know, call your senators, call your congressmen, vote. Don't let the giant corporations take away our net neutrality.
Oh no, definitely not. And you know, again, I want to thank you so much for being on. And just to let people know, again, tell them a little bit about the Zed Fest Film Festival where they can see Garden Party Massacre tomorrow night.
Oh, yeah. Tomorrow night, it's the final night. So there will be a bunch of films and then I think like a party. There's going to be food, drink, and awards, and it's going to be a lot of fun, and they have a red carpet, so if you show up, you can have a red carpet photo with me. I think the first block of films begins at 7, there's some short films, and then Garden Party Massacre plays at 7:30. It's in North Hollywood, and if you go to, gosh, any of my websites, there'll be a link to it, and you'll be able to find it. Hopefully there's still tickets available. We've won like 8 awards already, so, you know, people think it's good. Come and see it on a big screen while, you know, with me. And some of the cast is coming. Donna's coming. I'm pretty sure Lee's Hart is coming. I forget who else. But, yeah, it should be fun. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, like I said, I wish you all the luck, and I want to say congratulations on winning Best Feature Film at the Fantastic Horror Film Festival for Garden Party Massacre. And I hope you knock them dead with the more festivals you send it to, man. You're always welcome on the podcast. If you ever have any news you want out there on Morbidly Beautiful or Coffin Cuties Magazine, feel free to drop me a line, man, and I'll get you in there.
All right, man. I appreciate it, Michael. I appreciate your time and all your cool questions.
No problem, man. It was a thrill having you on, and I look forward to doing it again in the future.
All right, me too.
All right, take it easy, man.
All right, cheers.
And once again, I want to say thank you to Gregory Blair, the talented actor, producer, and writer. I wish Garden Party Massacre all of the success in the world, and I am looking forward to seeing more of Gregory's work here in the near future. Coming up in a bit, we'll be going into our next Digital Dismemberment Spotlight, and in it, we will be covering Scream Factory's release of The Hunchback from the Morgue, part of the 5-disc Blu-ray Paul Naschy Collection 2. But before that, we're going to go into our final Metal Massacre Spotlight for the evening. The name of the band is Cannibal Corpse, the CD is A Skeletal Domain, and the song is The Murderer's Pact.
Today.
And welcome back. You just heard Cannibal Corpse from the CD A Skeletal Domain, and the song was The Murderer's Pact. A Skeletal Domain was the 13th studio album from the American death metal band Cannibal Corpse. The album was produced at Audio Hammer Studios by Mark Lewis, and as an interesting fact, the album entered the US Billboard 200 at number 32, selling over 8,800 copies in just its first week. Make sure to head on over to their official website, head on over to Metal Blade Records, get the latest from Cannibal Corpse, tour dates, merchandise, and more. But now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time once again for some digital dismemberment. And in our final digital dismemberment spotlight for the evening, we're going to be covering Scream Factory's release of The Hunchback of the Morgue. This is the Blu-ray from the 5-disc Paul Naschy Collection 2 that was, of course, released by Scream Factory. And again, as I had mentioned before, this is considered to be Paul Naschy's ultimate film. This is the film that everyone talks about. That seems to be his legacy film. So without further ado, the premise of the film is that Wolfgang Gothu, played by Naschy, is a simpleton, homely hunchback who works for a hospital morgue. It is there that his childhood friend and the woman he loves, Ilsa, is awaiting death due to an incurable disease. After two coroners attempt to perform an autopsy on her body, Gothu goes bonkers, mutilating both men and stealing his beloved's corpse, taking her to an underground torture chamber where he likes to hide out. In the meantime, nutty scientist Dr. Orla, who also works at the hospital, moves his equipment down to Gotho's hideaway and promises to revive the dead woman in exchange for fresh cadavers for an experiment he's conducting. This poses no problem for Gothu, as he believes Dr. Orla can do it, and since he's completely homicidal, murder has become second nature to him. A nice engaged duo of doctors are soon introduced to Gothu and Dr. Orla's underground world of madness, and Gothu somehow attracts the romantic attentions of a pretty doctor named Elke, who manages to fall for the loathsome creature because of his tender side. Now, this 1973 offering by director Javier Aguirre is widely considered to be one of the best performances of Naschy's career, showcasing a level of depth in his character of the hunchback that few characters in his other films possessed. Filmed in several parts of Naschy's home country of Spain, it boasts incredible set pieces and crisp cinematography from Raul Perez Cubero that bring both a gothic sense of horror and a macabre beauty to a film that was a bit ahead of its time considering the subject matter, which included heavy tones of necrophilia. The effects work is quite stunning and will keep you on your toes, as there was a real corpse used in the head-severing scene. Now, a dummy head was later used as Naschy became too unnerved after slicing into the throat on the first take. The autopsy scenes really take on a different look after that, as you question whether or not they're using dummies or actual corpses, and the effects in other parts of the film are certainly graphic for their time period and extremely well done. Another bit of interesting history is the fact that live rats were used during filming, specifically the scenes where Naschy is attacked and where Maria Elena Arpon is laying on a slab in the underground tomb. Now, Naschy had to have rabies shots as a precaution, and those rats were later burned alive on camera for a different scene. Now, I had mentioned that earlier in the podcast, and please remember, it's not to make excuses, but this was certainly before all of the animal rights and the animal cruelty laws were in effect. So at the time that this was filmed, it was not a crime. Now, tie in a haunting score by Carmela A. Barnaglio, and you have all of the elements of an excellent, if not controversial, classic. Now, some spoiler alerts here. I'm going to go a little bit more in-depth into the movie. Now, the film opens up with Gotho walking down the middle of town late one evening, pausing to peer into the window of a local bar. Several medical students are inside, and a drinking contest ensues until one man passes out. Heavily drunk, the other man, whose name is Udo, leaves and stumbles through town, barely able to walk, and he drops a photo. Gotho tries to help Udo and return the picture, but is rudely received and told to go away. Not long after, Udo collapses due to what can only be considered acute alcohol poisoning, and his body is taken to the morgue. We later see that Gotho works in that morgue, and he seems to take great delight in removing various parts from Udo, all while cursing him for how he was treated during his life. He takes the parts to the dissection room, but is treated rudely by two doctors that are there. He leaves to go visit Ilsa, the young lady who was in the picture that was dropped by Udo, and she also happens to be a childhood friend of Gotho, and she always treated him well. Sadly, she is terminally ill in the hospital, but the time she and Gotho spend together appears to be the only bright spot in both of their lives. You can see that there's an obvious attraction between the two. The next day, Gotho is walking through the town when he is attacked by a group of young kids that call him names and throw large stones at him. One hits him in the head and he falls to the ground stunned. Now the children think it's funny and they laugh and run off, but a woman appears and helps Gotho to his feet. Now she is Dr. Elke, and she takes him back to her place where she bandages the cut on his forehead. Afterwards, to show his appreciation and thanks, Gotho gets down on his knees and kisses her feet. Later that day, he goes to visit Ilse again, pushing her in a wheelchair around the hospital grounds. As they talk, Gotho pulls a few roses for her and tells him how they make her happy and that she wishes to have a bouquet every day. He vows to bring her one every day from there forward when he comes to visit. The next day in the hospital gardens, he's picking flowers for her, but he's accosted by four young medical students. He drops the flowers and attacks them for the insults they pose to him and to Ilse. He fends them off until one manages to hit him with a shovel. He falls to the ground and they continue to assault him until Dr. Orla and Professor Tochter show up. They chastise the four assailants and help Gotho to his feet. Once standing, he picks up the flowers and he rushes to go see her, but sadly she dies just moments before he gets to the room. The nurse laments that if he had only gotten there just moments sooner, he would have got to talk to her before she died. Her body arrives at the morgue with Gotho looking on in dismay. Two more morgue workers show up and tell him to prepare her body for a dissection when they notice a gold chain that she is wearing around her neck. They make jokes about how she will no longer need it and attempt to steal it. Enraged, Gotho attacks and kills both of them with a hatchet. He scoops her body up and heads to some hidden catacombs outside of the town where the two of them can be together alone. Gotho later begins to exact his revenge on the medical students who made him late to his visit with Ilsa, killing them in a variety of ways. He is horrified to see that the rats have started to chew on her corpse when he gets back to the catacombs, so he moves her even further inside. Now the police are getting curious about all of the murders in town, and they begin to investigate and talk with the head of the hospital, Dr. Orla. He claims that Gotho would never hurt anyone, but later seeks him out to help with his own horrific experiments, promising to return Ilsa to life for Gotho as payment. Desperate to have her back, Gotho agrees, first stealing dead body parts, then killing for the doctor when asked. More trouble arises as a couple of lab assistants destroy her body by dissolving it in acid, throwing Gotho into another rage, killing them all. Orla then promises to make a new Ilsa for Gotho. Does the doctor live up to his word, and does Gotho find love after death? You're just going to have to watch and see. I don't want to spoil that. But the movie it's a very rich film, both in terms of atmosphere, camera work, the music. You know, it's a really well-crafted film. And, you know, Scream Factory being Scream Factory, we know we have our bonus features and our commentaries and things like that. The quality of the transfer on this is pretty stunning for its age, and it shows very little print damage and grain, except in a few places. Now, you have to keep in mind that for this transfer, the original prints could not be transported to America for remastering. Thus, the best quality prints that could be used were to put this film together. The mono soundtrack, both the Spanish and the English dub, are quite rich and have a very gothic sound to them. Included in the special features, of course, is the still gallery. Great look behind the scenes. You know, beautiful, beautiful photography. Once again, the audio commentary is very informative and sheds even more light on Nashi and the production. The packaging is very bold once again, and the artwork that comes with it is very much like the first box set, which I believe would be very suitable for framing and display. As well as the other releases in this set, it would have been fantastic to have had some featurettes about the film, as I've said before, but the commentary does a great job of filling that information in. The still gallery gives you a really good look behind the scenes. And just like the original box set, this also includes an immersive 24-page booklet by Arthur Mirek Lipinski, which has great photos, behind the scenes, quotes from people that worked on the film. So there really is a lot to like with this. Overall, I give this movie a rating, a 4 out of 5. I give the Blu-ray rating a 9 out of 10. And I would argue in most points that it would be a 10 out of 10, just having to be critical on the small end of it's a shame that they couldn't get the master prints from Spain over here to be fully remastered by Scream Factory Studios. Other than that, though, that's an extremely minor detail. Make sure to head on over to Scream Factory's official website, check them out on Facebook, check them out on Twitter, and make sure to order your copy of Paul Nashi Collection 2, including the film Hunchback of the Morgue. Well, I hope everyone has an absolutely fantastic Thanksgiving. I want to say thank you to my guest this evening, which was actor, producer, and writer Gregory Blair. I want to say thank you to Scream Factory for sending us our copy of Hunchback from the Morgue. That's part of the 5-disc Blu-ray Paul Nashi Collection 2. I also want to say thank you to Stephen Biro of Unearthed Films for sending us our online screener of Artraz. And I want to say thank you to our musical bands this evening, including Septic Flesh, Cannibal Corpse, and Cradle of Filth. Enjoy your holiday weekend, everyone. This is the Dead Man telling you all to rest in peace.